Sir, you're audible, sir. We can start.
Okay, thank you very much. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am Ulaganathan, as introduced by the coordinator. Yes, I'm going to speak to you on leadership for safety and safety culture. I have chosen this topic mainly because I am going to speak to my fellow safety professionals. So I thought it will be fit to talk on a useful topic which will be useful to the participants in developing themselves as safety professionals. Slide, please. The objective of this one-hour session is to explore and share ideas about some basic concepts of leadership and how they can be applied to OHS. Discuss human behaviors being the cause of several accidents and how it can be addressed. Share thoughts on developing a positive safety culture leading to a total safety management. So it is all interconnected. Actually, I am going to talk about the leadership qualities of any person and particularly relating it to safety professionals, and then talk briefly about human behaviors and how they attribute to cause of accidents, and link them both in bringing an approach for total safety management in through developing a safety culture for the whole organization. Slide, please. Okay, first we will start with the leadership and then we will go one by one. So what is leadership? Most of you are tending to be leaders. Some of you are already leaders, I don't deny. But most of us are trying to be leaders at one stage or other. So what is leadership? I have given four bullet questions. Where do you fit in your answer? Is it power? Whether power is a leadership? Or is it a status symbol? I am the leader. Is it that sort of thing? Or is it an authority? Once an authority is given, a leadership will come automatically or what? Just think over. Or is it a management? Any management will be a leader for that organization? Is it possible? It's like this. It's not power, definitely. Power derives from the status, money, ability to harm. If to do harm to any person, you require power. Okay, access to media or control and other actions. So that is power. But a thug who sticks a gun into your back has power, but is he a leader? Understand the point. A thug who sticks a gun in your back has got all the power. He can take away your life, but is he a leader? He's got power, but not leadership. That means power is not leadership. Like, it's not a status as well. Status or position may enhance the opportunity for leadership. Some in the high status or position haven't got a clue how to lead. I should not say, you see so many people in present day politics, they are having ample number of powers. They are very powerful, but are they leaders? They have got good status, they have got powers. Are they good leaders? I leave it to you. Many of them, to my knowledge, are not leaders at all. So is it authority? A person may have subordinate, but not followers. Okay, by that way also he cannot be a leader. He may have authority, he has got number of followers, but people will only follow if a person has a natural charisma and wisdom, and not just authority. Just authority will not be sufficient for him to be a leader. It's like this. A leadership is not management as well. Management is an organizational skill. Managers proceed over processes, functions, programs, but not people, because they are paid for that. They are paid to be managers for taking care of the process or taking care of different functions, HR, administration, maintenance, and whatsoever. So they are trying to manage the situation, but are they real leaders? So management is different, leadership is different. Good managers need not prove to be good leaders. Agree? Yes, please. Slide. Okay, now we'll see what is leadership. Leadership can be viewed as a dynamic process which involves a number of combined factors and phenomena. So it's a dynamic. It's not just one thing with which we can assess leadership. It's the ability to influence a group or team towards achieving a set goals. The set goals are common, which is known to the leaders as well as the followers. So it will be a common approach for the entire group to achieve that goal. So the leader should be capable of leading the team in such a way that he manages all his people under him to achieve the common goal. Outcome of effective leadership are behaviors and achievements of followers that are in line with the visions and strategies that are envisaged by the leader and his organization. So it is all integrated now. Outcome of the effective leadership depends on what? It depends on the behaviors of the followers. It depends on the achievements, the end result of the followers. That should be in line with the visions and the strategies of the management, which is driven by the leader. The leader says, this is our objective, this is our vision, our organization's goal is this, our target for this period is this. So he drives the message and followers agree to it and follow him because they are convinced. So they follow the leader inherently. So that is the type of leadership we are talking about. We will go into detail a little more. Slide please. Okay, visible leadership. The leadership can be visible or need not be visible also. There are several leaders who are not visible outside. But your visible leadership enhances the safety followers and their commitment levels. So they should know that you are the leader. You are the spirit behind their march. So you should be visible. There are ways for your leader to achieve things even without being visible. So we are not talking about that. For better results, the leader should be visible to others and his followers. Primary key for achieving safety culture. This is why, because the safety leader, their followers will lead to promote safety culture in the organization. So that is the end result we are going to witness today. So that's why this slide is there to link the leadership, the followers, and ultimately leading to safety culture. Slide please. Okay, traits of a good leader. We have seen enough now about a leader, follower, developing a safety culture, all being interrelated. We have also seen how a leader will behave and what are his capabilities. Okay, what are his traits? Once he has these following traits, he will be considered as a good leader. He should have trust. Whatever leader says, the follower should follow. Because of the trust they have in him, determination, initiative and perseverance should be well remarkable and understood by the followers. He should walk the talk. Means what? He should not just preach and forget it. He should also follow what he says. So he should set as an example for the followers to follow him. Let's walk the talk. Never turn a blind eye. Suppose some unsafe thing is going on in front of him, in front of his eyes. He should not have a blind eye. Oh, it will be like that. Boys are like that. He is only a new fellow. He has joined only yesterday. He will behave like that. He is ignorant. Like that, you should not get convinced and close your eyes. Okay. Whether he is a new fellow or an inexperienced person, you should look at him and try to correct him. So that the next time he will not do that mistake. So the leader should never close his eyes, and we should have open eyes to correct things whenever he sees them. Fixed responsibility and accountability of followers. See, what is the use of being leader? He should be able to achieve the end result. He should be able to achieve whatever is the goal. So for that, he should be capable of assigning responsibility to his followers, and assigning responsibility is not enough. He should also monitor how effectively they are doing, What is their accountability? If whether it is 50%, 60%, 80%, are they doing? Are they trustworthy? So this accountability of the followers should also be monitored. So you should be capable of assigning responsibility and quantifying the accountability of the followers. Competency and initiative. You should be competent enough to get things done. You should be aware of things. You should know what he is doing, and you should know what are the steps involved in achieving the goal. You should take proper initiative in taking the followers along with them, and you should also have initiative to convince all parties concerned. For example, the management. It is not enough if you convince the followers. You should also convince the management. So this is our common goal. We are also trying to help you. So you please help us. So that sort of a movement, a initiative, a drive towards different corners for achieving the common goal. Sense of responsibility. A leader is naturally a leader. He should have sense of responsibility. He should not wash off his hands. Okay. So he should first have this responsibility. He should realize that and act accordingly. Forward thinking. Okay. So far, so good. We have achieved up to this stage. So what next? What next? What to do? What are the possible hurdles? So they should think of that and pave a way for moving forward. Psychologically and emotionally stable. So otherwise you don't see a good leader at all, you know. He should be psychologically balanced, emotionally stable, and he should be well informed, he should be knowledgeable, he should be responsible. All these traits put together, he becomes a leader, or at least he will tend to be a leader. So once he develops, once he is experienced as a leader, and once he develops these traits, he will be a good leader. Slide please. Okay, your job as a safety leader is what? So far we have seen general leadership. So if you are a safety leader, all are safety professionals in front of me, all are safety leaders. So what will you do as a safety leader? Explain the HSE process, HSE aim, HSE goals of the management to employees. Who are the employees? Employees are supposed to be your followers because you are leader. So you are able to buy them, you are able to convince them, you are able to make all employees are your followers. So you explain what is the intent, what is the goal, how we are going to achieve that. Provide effective feedback. So if there is something wrong in the leader doing, or if the followers have some opinion on the leader's directions, they can come back and say. So you should be well open to the feedback. So sometimes unknowingly he may do some mistake which is not correct. So the freedom should be given to the followers for giving him your effective feedback, so that he will be able to correct his mistakes, and the path for the goal will be made easy. Intervene. Never walk past an unsafe act or condition. To do so is to approve or condone the activity or condition. We have seen this earlier. So it's not fair enough to close your eyes and walk past some unsafe things. So you should stop that. You should stop yourself. You should stop the job, and you should try to take care of the situation and rectify whatever wrong is done. Seek to understand why the situation or behavior is that way. So we are going to the next step. We have already started looking at the behaviors of the individuals. So by having a close knit of good followers, he sees that the behavior of all the individuals, the followers, are good. They are well behaved. They are able to listen to him. So they understand what is the goal. So that is a good behavior. But all employees are not having good behavior. You know, there are some people who have bad behaviors by virtue of so many other things which you will see in the future slides. So there are good behaviors and bad behavior. If someone is doing a mistake, unsafe act or unsafe condition, why he is doing that? Maybe because of some bad behavior he has developed over a period of time. So we should try to correct the situation or the behavior and make things all right. That is the job of a safety leader. So first you should understand why the individual is doing such a mistake. Is it because of some behavior? Is there any behavior issue? You should be able to correct, understand, and correct it, and so correct the problem. Yes, slide please. At-risk behavior. We talked about behavior of employees. At-risk behavior. What is at-risk behavior? We see a wrong electrical connection. Okay, one employee goes through that way. So if he is having a good behavior, what he will do? He will switch off. He will power off and make the situation safe. So he has removed an unsafe condition. That is a good behavior. He is having a safe behavior. On the contrary, if there is any other person who sees something unsafe, same example, electrical shock or something, electrical short circuit, what he will do? He is a person with at-risk behavior. He is not as good as the previous person. He is having at-risk behavior. Because of that, what he will think? Oh, it is not my job. Somebody else is doing it. So he will take care of it. Why I should bother about it? So that is called as at-risk behavior. If as a safety leader, if you see something taking a risk, you are authorized to stop the job. As a safety leader, you should be capable of stopping the job, talking to the persons concerned, explain the risk, because you have seen some risk involved. You should explain that to the individuals concerned. Explain the safe way. If he is not supposed to do this way, what is a safe way to perform that? If you ignore this, they continue to take the risk, and the at-risk behavior will continue to be existing with him. By a leader doing this corrective action, momentarily that at-risk behavior of the persons are also being corrected. So once and again, if such things happen, his at-risk behavior diminishes and he develops a good behavior, safe behavior. So that should be the objective of a good safety leader. So don't give up, adopt suitable counseling method to correct them. Because I told you, it is a behavioral problem. So he has got at-risk behavior. It is not necessary that when the leader tries to explain and correct him, he will not accept that. He will not understand that. He will still argue. I tell you, sir, it is not my job. It is somebody else's job. I am not supposed to intervene. So he will argue that way. So if he behaves like that, a leader should not give up. He should adopt suitable counseling method to correct them. So he should explain him. If it is left like that, there may be a serious accident within the next 2 minutes, within the next minute. So we should not wait for an unsafe thing to develop and cause some accident. So as it is fortunate that you have seen that, so you should be able to correct that. So we should be clever enough to handle the at-risk behavior person and make the situation all right. So this is good for the person with the at-risk behavior as well as the leader. So linking it to the safety culture, if more than several cases are corrected like this, the organization is moving towards safety culture, good safety culture. Slide please. Actions speak louder than words, isn't it? You agree to that. So whatever you speak for hours may be superseded by proper actions. Lead by action. As a leader, you should set as an example. Followers will subconsciously adopt your actions. They always pick up the bad habits first, because it is human psychology. The human psychology is in such a way that they pick up the shortcuts, they pick up the unsafe things, they pick up easy things. Whatever easy for them, they will pick up. They will not consider whether it is safe or unsafe. Okay, so you should take pay to show them the right way. You should explain what are the risks involved by adopting shortcuts. Nominate individuals and teams for awards and certificates. As a leader, it's not enough if you talk to them or if you take the followers along with you. You should also appreciate whenever good ideas come from them, whenever good suggestions come from them, whenever the follower does some mistake, you should be able to pinpoint that and you should be able to correct that. And this is not enough. You should also identify very good individuals for them, for some recognition, because it is always human mind seeking some recognition from some corner. So they have done something good. So why don't you nominate them for some certificate or some award or some appreciation from the management, or recommend him for some increment, whatever it is. Try to give some positive, incentive for him to continue the same thing. Team, and it is applicable for the teams as well. It is not for the individual alone. It is for the teams as well. Slide, please. Okay, now we go a little more in detail about the risk, at-risk behavior. We have seen at-risk behavior in one of the examples. A person who sees an unsafe thing with at-risk behavior is not able to take proper action because he is having at-risk behavior developed in himself. So at-risk behavior, what is at-risk behavior? Is the why we should give importance to that is that it is the root cause of several accidents or incidents which takes place in any organization. In your organization, there are hundreds of employees. All are not having the same good behaviors as you anticipate. Some are having safe, good behaviors. They are safety conscious. They will be able to do right things at right time. Whereas there are several at-risk behaviors. So many accidents are taking place because of the at-risk behaviors. You should be able to identify them and correct them. So that is the reason with which you should understand what is at-risk behavior. How at-risk behaviors become risky? Because they pose at present a at-risk work practice. Because persons with at-risk behaviors do at-risk work practices. They follow that because they are convinced within their mind, because of the behavior in them, they think that it is all right. It is not enough. It is okay. So that at-risk work practices cause near-miss accidents or sometimes accidents themselves. That accidents will lead to minor injury or serious injury or sometimes fatality also. These things are not new to you as safety professionals. So far we would have learned about accident causation, how accidents are caused because of unsafe act and unsafe condition. So this is not enough. We should go still more deeper. What is the cause for unsafe acts and unsafe conditions? It is the at-risk behavior of persons. So we have seen that 88% of the accidents are caused by human acts. So what caused that 88% of accidents? Because of the at-risk behavior of individuals. So that's why it is primarily important to correct the at-risk behaviors of employees who are committing unsafe acts and conditions, so that your overall safety culture is improved one day, so that your organization plays safe. So correcting the behaviors will effectively bring down the at-risk work practices. You should correct the behavior. What causes that at-risk behavior, you should identify and correct them. How to correct that, we will see in the future slides. Next slide, please. Okay, behavior-based safety. That is why it is called behavior-based safety. Nowadays, for the past a decade or so, a lot of importance is given to behavior-based safety. It is nothing but correcting the bad people as good people. How the people are bad? Because of their behaviors, because of their unsafe behaviors within them. How unsafe behaviors are built in a human being? That's what we are seeing now. Human behavior causes most accidents due to these bullet points. Seeking comfort, because they don't want to strain themselves. So seeking comfort, they want to adopt shortcuts. Shortcuts are coming from seeking comfort. Saving time, by doing it a proper way, it takes half an hour. By doing it in a shortcut, it takes only 5 minutes. So let me be prudent in adopting a shortcut and save time. So that is how the at-risk behavior person behaves. Convenience. This is convenient to do like this. You don't understand the risk involved in doing it in a convenient way. lack of understanding. All these things are because of lack of understanding. He has not developed his mind culture for understanding the situation, for understanding the risk. So it is lack of understanding. Why lack of understanding? Because of lack of training. That may be one of the reasons. I don't say that is a reason. It may be one of the reasons that lack of training is one of the reasons. That means his management has to look into where people lack training, and they should have their training programs and retraining programs, refresher training programs, contractors training programs, so on and so forth. So wherever lack of training is there, that should be properly addressed by the management. For doing so, the safety leaders and the safety followers will identify the problem and bring it to the attention of the management. Next thing is complacency. Oh, nothing will happen. He knows the risk. The at-risk behavior person knows the risk, but still he adopts to unsafe thing because of the complacency. So, wrong safety focus. So this, that is why he is a bad behavior base. So, he has a wrong safety focus. Misconceptions on safety. So, he has understood safety, but not in the right way. So, he understands safety that doing anything by him is safe. So, that is not correct. There are misconceptions in his understanding safety and his doing things. So, these misconceptions are to be relieved of. So, we have seen the root cause of the persons having bad behaviors. So, these things are to be addressed for changing them as a good, safe behavior persons. Next slide, please. Okay, now, I don't know, some of you would have heard about the ABC model, or some of you would have heard about it and forgot it. So now a refresher for understanding the people's behavior through ABC model. ABC, in the middle is the behavior, okay? We talk about a good behavior, understanding behavior, safe behavior, so that the persons do safe things always. They are able to quantify the risk. They are able to do right things at the right time. Okay, so we want everyone to be with a good behavior. But they are not so. Sometimes some people are not with good behavior because there are several activators. There are several activators which develop them to be a good behavior or to be with bad behavior. So what are those activators? There are some influences which move the person to be a good behavior or a wrong behavior. So what are those activators? All the events that precede behavior and prompt it. Yes, training. We have seen already training being one of the reasons. Personal beliefs. He believes that it is all right. It is enough. Complacent behavior. Behaviors of peace. Are I not only I am doing it, all my colleagues are doing it. All my peers are doing it. So that means what? All are having bad behaviors. All are not safe. The entire group is doing unsafe things. So one should copy the other for doing good, not for doing bad, not for adopting shortcuts. Not only me, I am doing a shortcut. My friend Ramesh, my friend Gupesh, everybody is doing the same way. So let me assume that it is a safe way. So these are the behaviors he receives from his peers. Sometimes he doesn't know that he is adopting bad behaviors from his peers. That should be noted and corrected. So past experience. So earlier he was working in a small organization or a carpenter or plumber. So where the safety procedures etc. are not that much. So he was allowed to have a free hand working with his own hands and with his own ideas. So that need not be all the safe, you know. So once he comes to an organization where safety procedures are there, he is reluctant to follow the safety procedures. Why? Because of his bad experience, earlier experience. Earlier he is not used to work with good procedures and supervision. So he thinks that that is the right type of working and he follows the same thing in an established organization also. And his social reasons. Okay. So social reasons could be anything like the adequacy, the availability, the people's education level, their poverty level, and so on and so forth. So they also influence a person to have bad behaviors. So all my people are not having enough food. So here, how I can spend enough time and energy wasting in doing these things right. So, okay, it's not, we are not grown up like that. Our elders, seniors have not taught us in that way. So it's not required. So the bent of mind can go in different directions because of their social background. Their educational background, they may be illiterates or they may be less educational required for the job. So that could also be one of the reasons. So there is no point in having a less educated, less experienced person in a job doing unsafe things. It is management's mistake. It is a supervisor's mistake to place a wrong person in the right place. So he has got social reasons, he has got educational lack of education, lack of experience. Then why the hell you place that person for doing the job? You should remove him. So this being one of the activators for his bad behaviors. Environmental influences, the same as the social, then have impact on behavior. So all these things will have an impact on the behavior. Okay, so these are the activators. To correct the behavior, what is the right way to do? Is to follow these activators. First, identify what causes the bad behaviors, and then you explore why they are having bad behaviors and try to identify the right activators which cause the bad behavior and attack at that place. If he is having lack of training, you train him. Personal beliefs, okay, correct them by proper training. Behaviors of peace, collect the entire group and educate them, train them. Past experience, so if you think that he will not fit in this place, remove him to your lower place. Okay, so like that, there are ways and means of acting on the activators which influence the behaviors. So these, all these things are part of the behavior-based safety. Identify the behaviors. Whenever they are bad, you try to find out what are the activators and correct them. Okay, we have seen the activators which influence the behaviors and what are the consequences. Consequences are events that follow the behavior. Okay, with a person with a bad behavior does wrong things, unsafe things. So that is the consequence. If the same behavior is corrected, he is able to do the things right because of his good behaviors. Now he is no more a bad behavior man. He is with a good behavior. Now he knows what is safety. He knows, he is able to understand the risk. So he is able to do a quality job, safety job. So events that follow behavior are the consequences. That may be good or bad. So you identify the activators because the consequences of the bad behavior person are all worse. It may end up in adverse consequences. Okay. So if it is having a bad behavior, it may end up in adverse consequences. Maybe severe and serious at times. So it's not necessary that they end up in only small accidents. As we have seen in the triangle earlier, it may even go to loss of life. It may kill a person. It may be, there may be a disaster. There may be a big fire incident. All because of the bad behavior, unsafe behavior of the individuals. So these are the consequences. So understanding the consequences, focus on the behaviors of the persons. And if they are having bad behaviors, identify the activators which influence the bad behaviors and try to attack the activators and correct them. This is simply the ABC model of behavior-based safety. Slide, please. Okay, so understanding people. This is what we have seen all along. So to see it in the perspective of correcting people, majority of all accidents are caused by people behaving unsafely. We have seen understanding employee behavior is fundamental to success of creating a safe workplace, isn't it? Because after all, the accidents are happening because of the employee behavior. We have to study that. We have to understand that. If they are wrong, we have to correct that. We have to identify the activators and correct that. Premise of model is that all behaviors are function of its environment, past or present. Okay, it is because of the influence of the environment, which from which society comes in. What is the level of education? What is the level of speech? So all this is account. This is the environment. We are not talking about the hot climate or weather conditions or something like that. It is the environment from where the bad behavior man comes in. What is his education level? What is the society from which he comes in? Okay. What is his background? What is his experience? What is his peers? Whether people are knowledgeable around him? So all these things will account. That is the environment. So not only the present, we should also take care of this past experience, knowledge, peer pressure and all these things. Because it is, the behavior is not caused because of the present environment. His past environment, past experience, past knowledge, past background, all these things contribute. So it will help you to understand better and correcting. Factors such as activators trigger on behaviors and sustain it for a long time. That's what we have seen. The consequences are the result of actions at varying behaviors. So what we are interested in is not to have the bad consequences which results in accidents, which results in fires, disasters, etc. We should try to control them by correcting the behaviors of the persons with bad behaviors, not necessarily behaviors of all. Persons with bad behaviors, we should correct them with identifying proper activators and attacking the activators. If you find lack of training, import training. Okay. If he is not at all suitable for that place, remove him and place him elsewhere. That is also one of the corrective measures. So like that, these are the points which enable you to understand the behaviors, their activators, with a clear focus on the consequences. Slide. Okay, this is another example for the ABC model. Someone is speeding the workplace, speeding to the workplace. Someone is going to the workplace or office or a factory, he is speeding the vehicle. Okay. Why is he speeding? Is it because of thrill? He's normally, so not only while going to the office or workshop, normally he drives the, like that. So that is the comment we receive from all the people around him. It, maybe it is for his thrill, or because he is late for work, he wants to make up time. Could be anything. Why is he speeding? Emergency. There is an emergency. There is an emergency with him or emergency in the plant. He is a resource person. He wants to go there and correct it. That is the reason why he is speeding. Or this is his attitude. Always he is like that. It is an excellent road. They would have recently laid the road and it is so nice for him, which motivates him to drive fast. So these are the activators. Ended up as crash, caught by police. Someone else ran off the road. So these are the consequences. You see, we are only focusing on the bad consequences. So there may be a crash, there may be an accident with other vehicles. He might have been caught by police. It is an undesirable consequence. So he is wasting a lot of time because he is already late. So he should not be further wasted going to the office. Sometimes the policeman drags him to the police station and he may have to lose his day's attendance. So this is a bad consequence. Someone else ran off the road. So because of his speed, he immediately an accident by which someone else is injured. So all these things are bad consequences. We don't want any such bad consequence to happen. So what we do? We attack on the activators. If he is thrilled, late for work, emergency attitude, all these things should be focused and we get that fellow and we should try to find out, talk to him and find out why he was speeding and try to correct that. Behavior work out through ABC. Activators, think of other hidden reasons. You should not forget that only all the activators are explicit. Maybe the individual would not have told the hidden reasons. Maybe he is ashamed of telling the real reasons. He may be hiding certain activators within him. So those points you should be able, with the leader, as a leader, you should be capable of identifying the hidden reasons and correcting them. As a leader, ask questions, comfort him, confirm him and comfort him. So, okay, nothing will happen. All my questions are only to correct you. we should not come across as consequences. So be frank, you tell the real reason for this. You should comfort him, you should convince him, you should properly counsel him so that he get the real reason for his behavior. Work out behavioral corrections. Once you identified proper activators which are resulting in the bad behaviors, your next step is to work out behavioral corrections by proper methods. Yes, please. Slide, please. Okay. So behavior-based safety basically is a bottom-up approach, because once you correct the behaviors of people down below, you come to a stage where all the employees or the followers, everybody is behaving safely. It is seldom you come across a person with a bad behavior. If you come to that stage, you are fairly good. You have laid your foundation good. Focus on employee behaviors. Okay. Then address root causes. The root cause of an accident should be because of any person, and the person's behavior is the root cause for that. So you continue to focus on the bad behaviors and correct them. Internal enforcement, whenever required. So you can bring in rule, right? Persons with a refresher training is not allowed to do this job. That is the internal enforcement. So that takes care of the inadequate training. Persons with less than 2 years experience are not supposed to be here. You give a ruling to the HR department, so they will transfer this fellow to some other place where the experience is not that much relevant. So these are the internal enforcements by which you activate some rules with which you are able to correct the situation. Concept introduction be simultaneous at all levels. So this will not go in piecemeal. Whenever you are correcting the behaviors of a group, you should go at all levels simultaneously. Otherwise, you will not be able to see good results. No? So you should be able to take these corrective measures across the group. Acts on peer pressure. This is the individuals are getting corrected. Suppose 80% of the people are corrected. Only 20% of the people with the stubborn bad behaviors are there to be corrected. Then what is the situation? The 80% of the people who are already corrected will be acting a pressure, peer pressure, on the 20%. Say, Aray, you are not listening to whatever said. It's really clearly explained that what causes the accident. Still you are doing the same thing. Still you are doing shortcut. Still you are not doing the right way. Like that, the peers at one stage, his colleagues will at one stage, will correct them. So that is a good sign. That is a good sign. So they are all becoming persons with good behaviors. So acts on peer pressure, that is the good symptom of the bad behaviors getting corrected. Positive result after successful implementation. Okay, this 80% becomes 90%, then 95%. So at that stage, you can claim yourself to be achieved positive result after successful implementation. The behavior-based safety program is successful once all the persons are well understood, their behaviors are corrected, there are no more shortcuts, no more bad examples of persons. So all are good. So when you achieve that stage, you know, successfully implemented the behavior-based safety program. Slide, please. So once you come to that stage, once you develop the group, the entire group, as a positive behavior-based people, it is easy for you to aim for a good safety culture of the organization. What is safety culture of the organization? Safety culture of an organization is a subset of overall company culture. A company, for example, take for example the leading concerns like a Tata or whatsoever, big companies are there with good culture. I'm not talking about safety culture. Whenever you tell that name, people recognize that company as a good company. So how this opinion comes in? This opinion comes in because of the company's culture. For example, you go into your company, X or B, X or Y or is a company. You go there. What is the first thing you see at the gate? There will be a security. There will be a team of security persons doing watch and ward. So what is their duty? As a visitor, they should come to you. They should approach you, identify you. Who are the person? What for you have come? Whom do you want to meet? Okay. Their credentials are to be assessed and then apply the relevant data in the register, then give you a safety pass, give you a safety briefing, and then allows you in. Once this happens, the organization is good. The organization is good with their good culture. Not only good culture, with the safety culture. Suppose you don't find any of these things in the organization when you go in. So the security asks for namesake. Yes, who are you? What do you want? I want to see Ramakrishna. Okay, so I'm going in. That's all. His credentials are not evaluated. Because the company, they are his superiors, his supervisors, his management has not enforced any of such things to the security guards. So they are ignorant. They allow you inside. So this is the first example of a good culture when you enter the organization. So as you go along inside, so the effective compliance to personal protective equipments, the way the other employees behave with you, whether they take you to the proper person, they take care of your safety requirements like issuing a safety helmet, shoes, badge, and all these things. So all these things add to the value of the culture. These are again and again we are coming to the safety culture. A good organizational culture is endless. It comes with their balance sheet. It comes with their corporate enforcement. It comes with so many things with their business ethics and so on and so forth. So safety culture is only a part of it. That's why I call safety culture of an organization is a subset of overall company culture. The safety culture of an organization often reflects the attitudes, beliefs, perceptions, and values of different cross sections. Okay, so it is the whatever section you go, whatever department you go, you should be able to understand safety is there. You should be able to feel safety is there. People are cultured. People are having good behaviors. Okay, there are no person with a bad behavior. There are no persons with at-risk behaviors. So this you should be able to feel across the organization, whatever department you go. You are in the security gate, you go to the admin building, you go to the workshop, you go to the place of work of the visit, I mean place, your guest, your host, you want to see. Okay, on the way you see so many things and everything should talk about the safety culture. It is the product of individual and group values that determine the commitment to and the style and proficiency of an organization's health and safety management. So it is not the individual effect, it is the group effect, and it determines the commitment of the management in achieving the health and safety proficiency. Organizations with a positive safety culture are characterized by communications found on mutual trust, by shared perceptions of the importance of safety, and by confidence in the efficacy of preventive measures. So, in a company where good safety culture is there, you can easily feel it. You can easily understand it. You talk to any person, not necessarily a safety person, not necessarily a process person. You talk to your office guy. You talk to your warehouse guy. Okay. Something related to safety. What is your safety policy? What is your accident statistics? Whether your senior management is interested in safety. Like that, you post some questions, very small questions, with which anybody can answer. So that you see the response coming from different persons, not necessarily process or safety people. Any person in office or warehouse or any watch and ward security or housekeeper, anybody should be able to give you a correct answer, because they are all groomed in a proper way with which the safety culture of the entire organization is taken care of. That's what we are talking about, a safety culture. Slide, please. Slide, please. Okay, safety culture. How you achieve safety culture in an organization? It is not one simple thing. For example, training. By giving a training over a period of time across different cross section of the employees, will you be able to achieve the safety culture? No. People listen to your training program in different ways. There are people who listen to it consciously, and there are people who listen to you carelessly. Some people will carry the message, some people will not carry the message. So the results are not uniform. So by that way, you cannot develop a safety culture. So there are several ways in which we should collectively try for a safety culture. For example, the management commitment. So as you have seen, the behavior-based safety is bottom-driven. Safety culture is top-driven. So you should come from the top management. The top management should have a desire to develop a good culture in the organization, and that also should pave way for safety culture. Organization, good culture for entire aspects of the business, production and business. Safety culture will be a part of it. So management should be committed to have a good organizational culture in which safety culture is a part of it. So that way, what he does here effective supervisor training, so that the supervisor's commitment is ensured. And he also ensures a teamwork. So not only supervisors, his subordinates, the actual working force should be made understood. Then it becomes a team. As a team, you try to achieve this safety culture. It will be easy. Okay, we cannot achieve a safety culture with just a few individuals. Your safety leader will not be able to do it without the management's drive, without developing it as a teamwork. Okay, your safety leader will be a catalyst in bringing in your safety culture in the organization through different teams. So it's a workforce involvement. Not only a team is a workforce, will also be a team. Safety rules and procedures. First, ensure you have adequate safety rules and procedures to follow. There are several organizations where enough safety rules and procedures themselves are not there. So their first step will be to initiate and form safety rules and procedures. Training. You have all this. You have developed groups. You are motivating them towards safety culture. You are having good safety rules and procedures you are trying to implement. It's not enough. People should be made understood on each and everything. That's achieved by proper training, retraining, refresher training. Okay. So training is not one-time activity. You conduct a training for a new employee, don't forget about training. After 1 year, after 6 months, you have a refresher training. Okay. There's a visitor coming in, so he doesn't know anything about your company. You have your visitor's training, briefing. We call it briefing. Organizational learning. So you share with your organizational learning to your workforce and all the teams, so that they are with you in all your directions. Safety communication is all the more important. Having safety rules and procedures is not enough. With proper safety communication, you see that the safety rules and procedures are implemented. People behave with a good safety knowledge, with less at-risk behaviors. Their safety is ensured. And other safety is also ensured. So this is all achieved with proper safety communication. Reporting system. Something happens somewhere. So there should be a good reporting system. Suppose there is a near miss accident, there should be a way of reporting even near miss accidents, not necessarily a big accident. Big accidents will somehow come to everyone's knowledge naturally, but small accidents resulting in a small injury to a person or a near miss accident. Okay, near miss accident, you are all safety people, I need not explain. So it is about to be an accident, but naturally, narrowly escape. So our report, all these things, bring it to the attention of all concerned people. What is the purpose? Is it for any particular interest? No. It is to prevent such things happening in the future. Okay, then work pressure. Work pressure may lead to adverse effects. So you try to relax the work pressure. Find out what causes the work pressure. Extended working hours or very strenuous job. Two persons doing three persons jobs. So what is the cause for real work pressure? That should be eased out. So like that, all these things contribute to good safety culture. It is not achieved so easily. All these things should be concertedly looked into and corrected so that a good safety culture emanates and continues and sustains in an organization. Slide please. Bringing up a safety culture. Whatever we have discussed so far will be in a summary fashion. Management's vision and commitment to be explicit. Nothing is concealed. Every employee of the company has the right to know the vision of the management and the commitment of the management. As long as they are with good vision and proper commitment, they won't be hesitant to share it with their employees. Successful behavior corrections of the individuals. We have seen all along, behavioral corrections, anything bad behavior should be corrected. So that we should have a team of persons with good behaviors. Choose committed safety leaders. We talked about the traits of a safety leader. It is not one safety leader. All your employees should tend to have all those traits so that you should have, the company should have a team of safety leaders. Whoever has that traits, all the traits, will be a safety leader. It's not necessary, it's not limited to one or two or three. Our ultimate aim is to have as many safety leaders as possible. At least they should have the traits in themselves. Emphasize safety as an integral part of business. Safety is a part of their business. If safety is achieved, their business is going through. Benchmark safety performance and monitor progress. Benchmarking is very, very important. There may be other organizations relating to the same operations. So evaluate, assess how they are doing. Focus on companies which are doing better than you and benchmark them. Okay, your accident rate is 2.1, for example. If the benchmark company is having 0.5, try to achieve their result. How do you achieve that? You learn what they are doing, you understand how do they manage things and try to adopt such things in your organization. So benchmarking is an important tool with which you can correct the bad things and pave way for good safety performance and a safety culture. Not only for the individual, it is good for all the peers and the employees around. Believing safety is everybody's responsibility. Okay, so we should drive that point. Everyone should understand and agree that believing safety is everybody's responsibility. Yes, safety is my responsibility. Right from security guard to the lower level workers, scavengers, housekeepers. Everybody should have this concept in their mind. I believe in safety. If you have seen places where stickers are given to people, I believe in safety. All the people will be wearing it. So it is their motivation for all people to be safety. Working safely is a condition of employment. That should be the case. If he is not having, if he is having any difference in opinion, he need not be part of the employee. He can be checked out, or they should take all possible means to bring him into the group of safety people. Working safety is a condition of employment. There is no excuse for that. Recognize and appreciate good deeds of any team member. If someone does good, okay, give a pat on his shoulder. Appreciate him. Announce that in the form of a circular. Give him an increment. Give him an incentive. Some motivation so that he continues. Not only he continues the same good thing, it is a motivation and a driving force for all others, for his peers and all employees, so that they will also try to get that motivation, achievement, and the pat on the back one day or other. So it improves the overall performance of all the people. Treat contract personnel in par with own employees. So we have seen places where contract personnel are treated differently. Safety, they are not at all considered as their employees. The safety preaching, safety training, safety consciousness impartment, everything will be to their employees. When it comes to contract employees, they say it is not their responsibility. That should not be the case. So there are ways and means of training and getting contract personnel to your side. You should adopt also all such things. If the wearing a PPE is a requirement for employee, it should be the same for the contract personnel as well. What you do for implementing this? Get the contractor and discuss with him. Your contract personnel should not be seen without proper protective equipment. He will say, no, I'm not paid enough for doing that. Okay, how much you got for implementing that? So there should be a compromise at that stage, and that should be taken care of as a part of the contract, and all the contract personnel should also be working along with the developed safety personnel. As far as safety is concerned, accident can happen to anybody, not necessarily an employee or a staff or a visitor or a contract person. So as long as you take protection against the possible accidents, safety is very good. So enforce this method and see that contract personnel are also taken care of. Responsibility for safety should be accountable. Okay, I am responsible for safety. It should not be a lip service. You should prove it once and again. All individual employees of the organization should be responsible for safety, and they should demonstrate it. Okay, they should be accountable. If there is any deviation, if they do some mistake, it should be accountable. Okay, so if you follow all these things, developing a safety culture will not be a problem. At least you should try and achieve that stage. One day or other, you will achieve, provided you don't give up your efforts in doing so. Slide, please. Key aspects of safety culture, once again. Safety culture means what are all the main aspects, main attributes. Management's commitment. I told you, safety culture is top-driven. So management commitment is foremost important. If they are not interested, if they are not committed, it's difficult to think of a safety culture in that organization. It should be a visible management. It is not just, just in paper. It should not be visible only in the circulars. It should not be just addressed in public forums and meetings. It should be visible. We should be able to, suppose there is a safety issue, how the management resolves it will stand as an example. So what they do is keeping safety in their mind. So that should be visible. That should be felt by all the people around, all the employees, all staff, all trade unions, all contract persons. So it should be visible. Felt leadership for safety. That's what I've been telling all along. Whatever the management does should be felt. Not only management, even the floor level, shop level people, whatever they do, whatever they speak, whatever they work, their methodology of working should be felt as a safe part of the safety culture. Okay. The leadership, it talks about the leadership. Leadership should also be felt by all the people working there and the management. Open interactive interaction between all levels. So the safety is not limited to management level or the working level. It should be properly integrated. Proper interaction between all levels is very important to maintain and sustain the safety culture. Employee participation is very much required, because he is not away from safety culture. He is a part of the safety culture. He is one who contributes to good safety culture. So we should always be a party in the safety culture, and you should actually participate. You should be allowed to participate, you should be motivated to participate in developing a good safety culture of the organization. Health and safety goals and benchmark targets. So you should set up proper health and safety goals for example, good companies like DuPont and other places, based on the results, safety results, accidents and other things, incidences, they fix up goal for the next quarter, next half year, next 1 year. So their aim or goal is to do better and decrease the accidents and the near misses and get a good statistics. So that is health and safety goals. And benchmark, I told about the benchmark in other related industries. How do they get it? How they are able to achieve good results? Follow them and try to do better and get good results. So this is the goals and benchmark targets. So once these things are appreciated, given value by the management as well as the people working under the management, a safety culture can be considered, can be thought of, can be achieved one day. It's like this. Symptoms of deteriorating safety culture. Okay, you have developed a safety culture, you have corrected the behavior of people, you have conducted a lot of training programs, all departments have participated. It took about 2 years or 3 years or even more to develop a good safety culture in an organization. But what is the guarantee that it will sustain? Sometimes it will deteriorate if proper attention is not paid, if enough proper steps are not taken to continue and sustain the safety culture, it will definitely deteriorate. But it will not be without any signs. It will show its signs that the safety culture is deteriorating. At least at that point, you should be able to recognize the weakness in the system and you should correct that. To mention a few, these are the few symptoms that indicate that the safety culture is deteriorating in an organization. That is, varying perceptions among managers and staff. The perceptions on safety should be the same. That's what we have seen in the earlier slides. If that perception changes, the risk level changes. Once the risk level changes, there will be some risk involving in some accident and incidents. That means your safety culture is going weak. Increasing accident and incidents. So your varying perceptions will vary the risk level and it also increase the accident and incident. That is the ultimate stage. If you see that ultimate stage, it is an indication that the varying perceptions among people are not recognized. Once you don't recognize that, accident and incident will evolve. So at least at that point, you should correct the deteriorating causes. Management of priorities shifting away from safety. It's a very good point. Sometimes it happens due to various pressures management faces. There may be some business crisis. The management may be involving losses, heavy losses due to market conditions or due to their competitor movements. His competitor has come up in business. So your business has gone down. So management loses interest in safety and turns their attention towards correcting the situations for making good profit. So that will be another sign of deteriorating safety culture. We should not give way for that. Anything happens, the attention given to safety should not be diluted or deteriorated. Visible lapses in compliance to health and safety policy and management system. Visible lapses. So procedures are not followed. Safety induction of a new employee is not taking place. Refresher trainings are not taking place. So these are the visible lapses in your compliance to HSE procedures. So at least at that point, good safety leaders recognize them and bring it to the attention of the management and try to correct them. Questioning the safety goals and set targets. The safety goals and targets are set with a lot of research and using the wisdom of safety leaders and the management's knowledge put together. If somebody questions that, if many people are questioning that, that means what? Their faith in safety is deteriorating. So they are not ready to go with the team. So they are not agreeing to the safety goals. When it will happen, for example, goals on the production. due to suffering losses, production losses will happen. Production losses lead to business loss. So they want to improve upon business. So naturally, they will try to adopt shortcuts. Trying to adopt shortcut means it's a deviation from safety. So this will lead to, the safety culture getting diluted or deteriorated. So these things should be understood and brought to the notice of the concerned people who are doing the mistake, and also to the top management for correcting the situation whenever it takes off like that. It should be better to correct at the early stage rather than giving a long rope. After giving a long rope, after a long time, it will be too difficult to correct the situation. Lack of employee participation in safety. Suppose there are no enough motivation for employees to follow safety, they will lose interest. So they will lose interest. What is that I achieved in doing following safety? Once this idea crops up in the minds of people, they will lose interest in safety. So management and safety leaders should see that such a temperament will not come to the minds of the people. So these are the brief symptoms of a deteriorating safety culture. Once you take care of this deterioration, your safety culture can be maintained, sustained for a long time. It's like this. Management support to optimize safety culture. I told you safety culture is top-driven approach. So management should properly have a commitment towards achieving and maintaining, sustaining the safety culture. So they demonstrate management support to safety culture. Empower employees. Employees should be empowered to work safely and do liberally. They should not be forced. Be on the vigil to control at-risk behaviors. If some at-risk behaviors, bad behaviors crop up in the minds of the workers, try to correct them in the early stages. Manage conflicts and promote team building. So it is always safer to work as teams, whether for good or bad. So team building is very good, and we should be working in the right way of a safety, following safety, and it should be easy to sustain them. If they integrate, disintegrate as individuals, every individual will take its own course and it may deteriorate faster. So management, conflicts, and promote team building. Have a time scale fixed for addressing safety issues. Any safety issues, corrective issues, should be on a proper time scale so that it don't take too long to correct the situation. Optimize safety management systems that are easily understood. Safety management systems should be optimized for better understanding and easily following. It should not be tedious. Emphasize the safety advantage in all training programs. Motivation and incentive should be complementing each other, and there should be a continuous factor for sustaining the safety culture and having the momentum well driven through the minds of the employees. Slide, please. Yeah, we have come to the last slide. To conclude, we've talked about safety leadership, at-risk behaviors, and ABC model of attacking bad behaviors, and finally the safety culture. All are interlinked. So you should appreciate that all the three factors are interlinked. So to conclude that, at-risk behaviors remain the major cause of accident and incident. Do you agree? That's only to emphasize this point, I once again show you the triangle with which all you safety guys are familiar with. We have seen up to near misses, okay, and to some extent the bad risk. Beneath the bad risk are the at-risk behaviors, the behaviors of people, or the resulting in taking undue risk, which causes the accident and incident. So at-risk behaviors are fundamental in safety. At-risk behaviors remain major cause of accident incidents. Once that is corrected, all the other things are taken care of. Behavior-based safety under an able leadership would enhance HSE management. So maybe you have a good Let me change over the give me a minute. In a major cause of accident incident, we are aware of that. Behavior based safety under an able leadership would enhance health and safety management. We have seen that. Felt leadership for safety is vital for developing a positive safety culture. Okay, the leadership should not be for namesake. There should not be a namesake leadership. And we have also seen that it's not just one or two leaders. Everybody in the organization should have good leadership qualities. Good leadership traits, whether they are recognized as safety leader or not, they should have the leadership quality in them. So their leadership is felt by all their peers and others. So that all these things move towards positive safety culture. Positive safety culture can only be developed with the sustained efforts of effective safety leadership with unstinted commitment and support from the senior management. As I am repeatedly saying, because it is top driven, senior management commitment should be there and should be sustained all along to develop and maintain a good safety culture in their organization. I also told you that it is not safety culture is not a separate entity. It is a part of their overall management's culture. Okay, it is not it's the company culture. Safety, once company culture is good, it takes into account everything together, including safety. So ultimately, it should be a cultured company, and safety culture should be a part of it, well-deserved part of it. So these are the, that's all, please, slide. Okay, thank you. Next slide, please. Okay, these are my contact details. And as you know, I am the Vice President of Safety Engineer Association. I give the contact details of Safety Engineer Association. We got a website, www.safetyengineersassociation.org. You can go see the site for more details on more on our activities. And if you like to become a member of the association, you can download the application from therein and become a member. Or you can use the email ID given below to send mail and get application form and get yourself part of the association. This information is for the people who are the visitors, guests for today's webinar, and for those who are interested to be part of the safety association. Well, gentlemen, this is all I wanted to share with you today, as requested by Dr. Sriram and company. Thanks to Dr. Sriram, Dr. Srinath and his group for giving me an opportunity for sharing an important topic with you. Hope my topic and presentation is understandable and it's all agreeable, and hope it will be of some use to you at some stage of your professional life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was a very informative session for us. We have a few questions from some of the attendees. Can we take the question answer session now?
Yeah, please, one by one.
Okay. Mr. Murali TR is asking, with more and more outsourcing, what is your suggestion to bring the different partners to our organization's safety expectations?
It should be part of their organization's plans. if it is a hindrance, they should discourage that, and they should avoid that as much as possible. And when they are adapting to a particular way of implementing their programs, they should be have a safe way of implementing that. That's what I could say. If it is a hindrance, stop that. If you want to continue with that, develop, evolve a good system so that it takes care of the problem. This may answer.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And Mr. Marimuthu ji is asking, if more contractor workers utilizing company can implement BBS?
Yeah, PPE normally is the responsibility of the contractor. That's why I said the management, before awarding the contract to any particular company, should talk about the issue of safety, implementation of safety aspects in the organization, and particularly with respect to issue of personal protective equipments. It should be visible, clearly visible in the contract, and it should be properly addressed. Whose responsibility is that? Whether it is client's responsibility or contractor's responsibility, and if it is contractor's responsibility, the responsibility should be well driven, and they should be well understood on that. Any issue arising because of the cost of the contract, that should be addressed between themselves. That, I mean, the cost of the contract should not, should not be the cause of the non-implementation. Hope I made my point clear.
Okay, thank you, sir. Mr. Jay Prakash is asking, safety contact is the only tool or any other method available for correcting at risk behavior?
We have seen enough tools, the activators. We have seen the activators of bad behaviors or good behaviors. You should identify the proper activators and address them. The activator could be anything like a societal reason or the environmental, which society belongs to. Is it a well-developed society or a downtrodden society? What is his education level? What is his basic knowledge? Whether he is sufficiently qualified? What is his training levels? All these things will go into it. It is not just talking or training. It could be any of this. So identify what causes the bad behaviors and tackle the activator with the proper control measures. It could be anything between proper training or talking to them, addressing or make him convince that following safety measures are for his own good and for the good of others. And once you take him by your side, it will be easy for you to get along and correct the behaviors of bad behavior people.
Thank you, sir. Well, we have that much questions only. Is there any questions from the attendee side? You may raise your hands and we can take your questions now.
The lesser the questions imply that my presentation was good and people understood it clearly. On the other hand, they have not understood anything. So this being a simple safety lecture, all participants being safety professionals, I assume that my message, my presentation is well understood and well taken by the participants.
That's nice, sir. And one more question from Mr. Muralidhara BK. What is the recommended percentage safety for safety budget?
That's unlimited. That should be unlimited. The organization where I worked, not the organization, the organizations where I worked, the safety budget used to be unlimited. There are several heads for various activities in the organization, but you won't see a heading like safety, because when it is questioned, my senior management will proudly say that there is no budget for safety. Safety. It's not no budget, it is open budget. You say $100 million, they will be ready to do that. It is like that.
That's interesting, sir. Mr. Marimuthu ji and Aristus Raja is complimenting you. We understood it well, sir. It was an excellent presentation.
Is there any question?
No, sir. They are complimenting you.
Okay.
That
okay.
They understood it well and it was an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Mr. Marimuthu ji wants to ask you a question. I'm trying to allow him to talk, but there is some network issue. There is some network issue, Mr. Vidyasagar and Mr. Marimuthu. So I am not able to accept your request for allowing you to talk. So can you please put forth in the Q&A box?
Or to my email straight away.
Yes, you have sir's email ID and contact details now. You may also raise it to him.
Okay.
That's it, sir. We are not having any more questions from attendees.
Good. Thank you.
Okay. One last question from Mr. Bhupati Raja. Can you share some methods to implement visible leadership?
Visible leadership, yes. One who demonstrates whatever we have discussed is a visible leader. That means, see, he may be a good leader within himself, but he will not be able to be explicit. That's what we mean by visible leader. A visible leadership will be able to achieve good results, and he will be an interface between the management and the workers, the fellow workers. Okay, so that way, and he should see, he should exhibit the good traits in him. For example, when he walks across a workshop, somebody does an unsafe thing, he should be able to stop that and correct it. He should not close his eyes and walk. So once he does this across the workshop and several occasions, people will realize, understood, and take for granted that he is a good leader. He is proving himself to be a leader. So this should be well recognized, and people should understand and appreciate it. That is what is meant by felt leadership, visible leadership.
He also asks, is BPS a part of safety culture?
No, that paves way for developing a good safety culture. Without correcting the behaviors of people, how do you ensure you achieve your safety culture? People with bad behaviors, if they continue to be part of your organization, you cannot dream of your safety culture, good safety culture in your workplace. So as we've seen, people, workers, staff, the whole entire team of people contribute to the safety culture. If your safety culture needs to be good, your contributors should be good. They should be well balanced. They should be well behaved. If they still continue to have bad behaviors, they will not be able to contribute for the good safety culture of the organization. That's why it is closely related.
Okay. In continuation with the BBS, Mr. T.C. Vidyasagar asks, while missing design safety people, prefer BBS. Is your view on this?
Sorry, it's not clear.
While missing design safety people, prefer BBS. Your views on this?
Missing design. I don't see any relationship between missing design and a behavior based safety.
Can I repeat, sir?
Yeah.
Mr. Marimuthu is asking, as per BBS, safety is a value or priority?
Both.
Okay.
It is a priority because it is a value.
Great. Okay. And once again, Mr. Bhupati Raja is asking, is it punishment will give better results to change at the risk behavior for attitude issues?
Punishments are fetching results, no doubt, but they are short-lived. You cannot expect a long-lasting solution from giving punishments. We have seen places where they cut off their increments, where they force them to take go on leave. So many negative aspects are there. I don't advocate for that because they are short-lived. And on the other hand, they develop antagonism on the part of the affected individuals. So try to be positive and try to develop them in a positive way. That will pay good results. But it may take time. You may have to wait for good results. But your negative motivation will immediately give bad results. So we will prefer a delayed positive result rather than a accelerated negative result. This is how I look at it.
Positive reinforcement is any day a better option. Yeah. Any more questions from the attendees? Can we wait or can we wind up, sir? No further questions, sir, from the attendees.
Okay.
Shall I render the vote of thanks? All right. Here I am going to render my vote of thanks. Organization expert Baron Bennis once said, "Leadership is the capacity to translate vision into reality. Translating safety vision into a reality where continually reducing exposure is an organization value is a true test of leadership." In short, from today's webinar and takeaway, successful leaders doing the following. They articulate the big picture, they plan for barriers and strengths, they define clear expectations. Honing your personal ability to influence, engage, and inspire others will go a long way toward realizing your vision for an organization that demonstrates its value for human life in the way it conducts business every day. That's all for today, folks. You can view and share this presentation on our YouTube channel named Safety Cluster. You can like, share, and subscribe to your circle so that many others will get benefited from our sir's presentation. Thank you once again, sir, for a very, very in-depth presentation on safety, leadership, and culture. See you all on another Sunday for once again an informative session like this. Thank you so much.
Let me also thank the Safety Cluster for the opportunity given to share my views with my fellow colleagues, and thank you for your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, attendees. Thank you, participants and organizers. Thank you.